Hello everyone, welcome back to our channel startuplanes.com. My name is Harshali, and as you know, these are the series of interviews that we conduct for the CEOs and the founders of some excellent startups. For today's interview, we have with us Mr. Akshay, who is the co-founder of Kazam EV. Their startup's motto is to make renewable mobility available to everyone. They also provide products and services which primarily include hardware like smart charging stations supported by our mobile applications and various other softwares. So let's know more about his startup from Mr. Akshay himself. Good afternoon, sir. Thank you for joining today. I am Harshali Rao, Community Manager from Startup Planes, and we are very grateful to have you on board for this meeting. Kindly just give an introduction of yourself to the viewers.
Hi everybody, this is Akshay here. I'm the co-founder of Kazam EV. We make electric vehicle charging infrastructure for India. It's a completely inbuilt infrastructure company that we have built based out of Bangalore. And we're developing for India and for Indians, and look forward for the chat.
My very first question to you is that have you always wanted to launch this startup, or is there a story behind it?
I always wanted to be an entrepreneur, okay? So I would not say that I wanted to launch just this startup. I never really dreamt of, opening an EV charging company. But I always wanted to be an entrepreneur. And this is not my first venture. This is my second venture. And it just so happened that my partner was in the energy space. He was in Sunroof. And he reached out to me somewhere around last year, June. And I thought it was a great idea, so we kind of jumped in and we thought of doing this.
So like every success story has struggles behind it, which nobody knows. So can you please share what struggles you had to face to reach this point?
I think my struggles started as a right in childhood. You take up the right steps, you kind of build trust in people, because you have a lot of responsibility as you grow older and older, right? And it becomes very difficult to convince your parents or people who you are responsible for that you are going to take such a step, because everybody is scared, everybody wants a stable platform, right? And I think that has been the biggest struggle. But then as an entrepreneur, you face this on a daily basis. You not just from people who you are responsible for, but it could be when you started off, when nobody knows about Kazam or nobody knows about you, right? It becomes very difficult for you to convince, say, a vendor or even a customer. And there are a lot of rejections on a regular basis, right? From investors to vendors, suppliers, everybody rejects you. And going through that, jumping through that, I think is a mindset that you need to have as an entrepreneur. So those are the major struggles that you get on a daily basis. But other than that, I think I've been very fortunate enough to find the right set of people. Finding talent is very extremely difficult. The right set of talent, the right set of cohort members. So yeah. So that has been the second biggest challenge for us.
So was there ever a moment when you felt like giving up?
I think I have been a thicker rock right now, because I've been more thick-skinned, because it's my second venture. Yeah, in my first venture, when I was just 22 years old, that's when I always felt like giving up. But again, when you have co-founders with you, when you have somebody with you at that same level, it becomes very easy for you to communicate what you've been feeling emotionally, because there could be days that you may not feel good, but the other person is holding the fort for you. So it becomes very important to have then a co-founder who can, bring back to you at the mental state that you are. Yes, there would be days that you would not be successful, and there would be days where you would be extremely successful, and so it does happen. But I have never really felt like I should quit. So
yeah. How would you describe the work culture of your startup?
Very open. We don't have there is no hierarchy as such. We have a place, we have got a cafeteria right into the campus where we are staying. We've actually converted a big bungalow into an office space. So we all, the whole tech team stays on the first floor, and then we work on the ground floor. So visit, and maybe in some days we'll be putting out a video about how we have set it up. So on the outside, right, we have a garden where we placed out chairs and tables where people can come, sip coffee, play some games, board games, and also work together. So we want it to be a very chill atmosphere. We want it to be a very happening place for people to come and enjoy, make friends, and also work at the same time.
So in what ways do you believe that you are better than your competitors?
We are an innovator, okay? I believe that it's in our DNA that we want to build the best products, and we want to build it for the consumers, right? And we will keep on innovating. We don't stop in the sense that, we've got achieved certain numbers, we've got a stable product, now why don't I stop? No, that is not in our DNA at all. We will keep pushing the boundaries and we will keep on innovating till the time, then there's no limit to it. To innovation, and because technology will keep on changing, and that is the reason why we've been very successful. And second is our go-to market. We are extremely fast. This company is 6-7 months old, but most of my competitors are either 100 years old, which is Siemens, ABB, etc., or they are, again, there are startups, couple of them, but they have also been a couple of years old. In our purview, in the last 6 months, I don't see any of my competition, and we've really caught up with the ones who have already been in the market for 3 years. So I think we're very fast. That's how we operate.
So as you said that you had founded a startup before this, so was it successful?
Partially, yes, it was, because I was into the augmented reality and virtual reality space slightly very early, and built the product, struggled a lot with managing people. Because I had to convince a lot of people who were very elder to me to believe in me, and this was back in 2015, and a lot of people did not really were into the startup phase at that point of time and didn't really understand the code, right? So it was very difficult, but I did that for almost one and a half years, yeah, and sold that company out and exited and moved into another venture.
So if not your startup, what would you be doing right now?
I would be traveling. So I have this fantasies, or you can say that I generally pursue a lot of traveling, and I would be traveling, backpacking. I don't really have fancy traveling things in my head. It is more about understanding the culture, living as low as possible, as minimalistic as possible, living in hostels and traveling. So that would be something that I would do, and rather I think I will still do, if not my startup, or even if my startup goes, right, maybe a couple of years down the line.
So your startup was recently in the news for successfully closing a funding round. So as funding is very crucial part, when did you decide it was time to raise external funds?
See, we wanted to make a minimum viable product, and wanted to have confidence in ourselves that what we're thinking of in the idea stage is something that can be done, right? So we did our initial market research, both primary and secondary, built the MVP, and when it was almost ready, that's when we went to market. So we did a lot of things simultaneously. Even before the product was done, we started selling the product. We got orders even before the product was made, in a pre-booking concept. So we said that we're launching this, why don't we pre-book? So we had orders before the product came out. As soon as the product came out and we were sure that yes, now it was working, we immediately went to market and we said we want to raise funds. And we were lucky enough to close within the first few interactions that we had.
So was it easy to raise funds? I mean, what did you do to search for investors?
What did I actually didn't do much. I had an experience with my previous startup of raising funds. That was a time when I learned a lot about raising funds. So I kind of reached out to people in my circle. I wanted to do a friends and family round, but then I thought that it would, the money that we needed was much more than what my friends and family would be able to do. And also we had reached the MVP stage. So we wanted to kind of raise funds to our growth story, to initially lay down the first few customers and our supply chain problems. So we wanted good amount of funds, and that's when we reached out to angel networks, we reached out to VCs, and they were more than happy to talk to us. And some of them clicked very fast. So the ones who moved faster kind of got into, you know, being funding us.
So did you ever face rejections from the investors? Like, what was the reason and how did you handle it?
See, as I told you, rejection is a, you know, part of an entrepreneur on a daily basis. And I think that is going to happen till the time you're an entrepreneur. And you should have that thing ready with you in your head that, yes, you're going to face rejections on a daily basis. There are investors who have their own mindset because they do a lot of research and this. Whereas we entrepreneurs, we have our own mindset. We have this rebellious nature to innovate something which, you know, people will laugh at. So, you know, sometimes you do get rejected for that particular reason because your idea seems too ridiculous for somebody to believe in. So, yes, I have faced rejections on that front. But moreover, I think everybody knows that EV is the future. And so a lot of them were very clear that, yes, this is going to happen. But whether it is the right stage for them to enter, was something that they were not clear on. So we're still in touch with most of our investors.
So how would you describe your whole journey as an entrepreneur in one word?
I would say it is fascinating.
Okay, so is there anyone from your family or your team who you want to thank for the constant support throughout your journey?
There are a lot of people. See, behind any successful entrepreneur, there's not just one or two people, right? I have been very fortunate enough first to, you know, being brought up very well in terms of my parents were entrepreneurs, but not very big entrepreneurs. They had their own, you know, self-employed kind of business, and that gave me the basic DNA. Second is all my friends, because, you know, your whole base is built on your childhood. And I was fortunate enough that I could interact with so many people, get all that information that I had. And finally, all the colleges that I went to, right, that kind of built the person that I am. The choices that I took that time or were available to me at that point, like I went into being the general secretary for my college. So it kind of gave me that, you know, I added knowledge base of how to manage people, how to manage a whole, you know, university. So there were a lot of decisions that came in place. So I did a lot of networking when I was in my company where I was working with PepsiCo. So they have also been very helpful for me in terms of being where I am, right? So I wouldn't want to name one person and miss out the rest. So I would say that all of them have been very extremely important for me. And you know, even without, I think, one or two being there, it would have been very difficult.
So what are your thoughts and feedbacks for starting?
So I think you guys are doing a wonderful job, especially reaching so many people and also bringing out stories about, you know, entrepreneurs, their struggles, because a lot of people don't understand the dark side of it, where, you know, it is actually very difficult to, you know, being funded, trying to build something out of, you know, scratch, out of nowhere. And there are hardly 1-2% who are very successful in building something. So I think it's a great opportunity for young minds and also, you know, whoever wants to start up something on their own. And
So we have several aspiring entrepreneurs watching our channel. So would you like to say a few encouraging words for them?
Yeah, so as I was telling, never really lose hope as an entrepreneur. Second is, you know, be curious all the time. Ask the question why, whenever it is, right? Never settle for that. And third thing is, you know, you need to have a little bit of courage. And you should, you know, if you don't have something, it doesn't mean that you have to do it yourself as an entrepreneur. A lot of entrepreneurs think that you need to do things, everything by yourself. But if you don't know something, it is very good to outsource. And this I learned from my previous organization when I was building my first startup. So if you don't know something, it is good to outsource. There's no problem.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for joining today.